Have you ever put away a bag of chips because they say it isn't healthy? That makes sense. Have you ever put away a bag of chips because you want to increase your chances of having more children so we can populate the entire galaxy in a billion years? That makes you a long-termist. Long-termism is a currently popular philosophy among rich people like Elon Musk, Peter Thiel, and Jaan Tallinn. What do they believe and how crazy is it? That's what we'll talk about today. This video was made possible by Squarespace. That's a platform on which you can create your own website with just a few clicks. Whether you need a professionally looking website for your research or want to set up a blog for your travels, you can do it on Squarespace. And it's not just that they have a great selection of templates that'll get you started. You can also use this platform to set up and manage an email list, add buttons to accept donations, and keep track of who's visiting your website. So go check out squarespace.com for a free trial. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/Sabine to save 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Now let's talk about the long-termists. The first time I heard of long-termism, I thought it was about terms of agreement that get longer and longer. But no. Long-termism is the philosophical idea that the long-term future of humanity is way more important than the present and that those alive today, so you presumably, should make sacrifices for the good of all the generations to come. Long-termism has its root in the effective altruism movement, whose followers try to be smart about donating money so that it has the biggest impact, for example, by telling everyone how smart they are about donating money. Long-termists are concerned with how our future will look like in some billion years or longer. Their goal is to make sure that we don't go extinct. So stop being selfish, put away that junk food and make babies. Here's a visual illustration of this. Each grain of sand in this hourglass represents 10 million people. The red grains are those who lived in the past, about 110 billion. The green ones are those alive today, that's about 8 billion more. But that's just a tiny part of all the lives that are yet to come. A conservative estimate is to assume that our planet will be populated by at least a billion people for at least a billion years. So that's a billion billion human life years. With today's typical lifespan of 100 years, that'd be about 10 to the 16 human lives. If we go on to populate the galaxy or maybe even other galaxies, this number explodes into billions and billions and
billions and billions and
billions and billions and
billions and billions and billions.
Unless we go extinct. Therefore, the first and foremost priority of long-termists is to minimize existential risks. This includes events that could lead to human extinction, like an asteroid hitting our planet, a nuclear world war, or stuffing the trash so tightly into the bin that it collapses to a black hole. Unlike effective altruists, long-termists don't really care about famines or floods because those won't lead to extinction. One person who's been pushing long-termism is the philosopher Nick Bostrom. Yes, that's the same Bostrom who believes we live in a computer simulation because his maths told him so. The first time I heard him give a talk was in 2008, and he was discussing the existential risk that the programmer might pull the plug on that simulation we supposedly live in. In 2009, he wrote a paper arguing, a non-existential disaster causing the breakdown of global civilization is, from the perspective of humanity as a whole, a potentially recoverable setback, a giant massacre for men, a small misstep for mankind. Yeah, breakdown of global civilization is exactly what I would call a small misstep. But Bostrom wasn't done. By 2013, he was calculating the value of human lives. We find that the expected value of reducing existential risk by a mere 1/1,000,000,000 of 1 percentage point is worth 100 billion times as much as a billion human lives in the present. One might consequently argue that even the tiniest reduction of existential risk has an expected value greater than that of the definite provision of any ordinary good, such as the direct benefit of saving 1 billion lives. Hey, maths doesn't lie, so I guess that means it's okay to sacrifice a billion people or so, unless possibly you're one of them. which Bostrom probably isn't particularly worried about because he's now director of the Future of Humanity Institute in Oxford, where he makes a living from multiplying powers of 10. But I don't want to be unfair. Bostrom's magnificent paper also has a figure to support his argument that I don't want to withhold from you. Here we go. I hope that explains it all. By the way, this nice graphic we saw earlier comes from our world in data, which is also located in Oxford. Certainly complete coincidence. Another person who has been promoting long-termism is William MacAskill. He's a professor for philosophy at, guess what, the University of Oxford. MacAskill recently published a book titled What We Owe the Future. I didn't read the book because if the future thinks I owe it, I'll wait until it sends an invoice. But I did read a paper that MacAskill wrote in 2019 with colleague Hilary Greaves titled The Case for Strong Longtermism. Hilary Greaves is a philosopher and director of the Global Priorities Institute, which is located in, surprise, Oxford. In their paper, they discuss a case of long-termism in which decision makers choose the option whose effects on the very long-run future are best while ignoring the short-term. In their own words, the idea is then that for the purposes of evaluating actions, we can in the first instance often simply ignore all the effects contained in the first 100 or even 1000 years, focusing primarily on the further future effects. So in the next 100 years, anything goes, so long as we don't go extinct. Interestingly enough, the above passage was later removed from their paper and can no longer be found in the 2021 version. In case you think this is an exclusively Oxford endeavor, the Americans have a similar think tank in Cambridge, Massachusetts, called the Future of Life Institute. It's supported, among others, by billionaires Peter Thiel, Elon Musk, and Jaan Tallinn, who have expressed their sympathy for long-termist thinking. Musk, for example, recently commented that MacAskill's book is a close match for his philosophy. So, in a nutshell, long-termists say that the current conditions of our living don't play a big role and a few million deaths are acceptable so long as we don't go extinct. Not everyone is a fan of long-termism. I can't think of a reason why. I mean, the last time a self-declared intellectual elite said it's okay to sacrifice a million people for the greater good, only thing that happened was a world war, just a small misstep for mankind. But some people have criticized long-termists. For example, the Australian philosopher Peter Singer. He's one of the founders of the Effect of Altruism movement, and he isn't pleased that his followers are flocking over to long-termism. In a 2015 book titled The Most Good You Can Do, he writes, "To refer to donating to help the global poor or reduce animal suffering as a feel-good project on which resources are frittered away is harsh language. It no doubt reflects Bostrom's frustration that existential risk reduction is not receiving the attention it should have on the basis of its expected utility. Using such language is nevertheless likely to be counterproductive. We need to encourage more people to be effective altruists, and causes like helping the global poor are more likely to draw people toward thinking and acting as effective altruists than the cause of reducing existential risk." Basically, Singer wants Bostrom and his likes to shut up because he's afraid people will just use long-termism as an excuse to stop donating to Africa without benefit to existential risk reduction. And that might well be true, but it's not a particularly convincing argument if the people you're dealing with have a net worth of several hundred billion dollars, or if their expected utility of existential risk reduction is that their institute gets more money. Singer's second argument is that it's kind of tragic if people die. He writes that long-termism overlooks what is really so tragic about premature death, that it cuts short the lives of specific living persons whose plans and goals are thwarted. No shit. But then he goes on to make an important point. Just how bad the extinction of intelligent life on our planet would be depends crucially on how we value lives that have not yet begun and perhaps never will begin. Yes, indeed. The entire argument for long-termism depends crucially on how much value you put on future lives. I'll say more about this in a minute, but first, let's look at some other criticism. The cognitive scientist Steven Pinker, after reading MacAskill's What We Owe the Future, shared a similar reaction on Twitter in which he complained about certainty about matters on which we're ignorant, since the future is a garden of exponentially forking paths, stipulating correct answers to unsolvable philosophical conundrums, and blithe confidence in tech advances played out in the imagination that may never happen. The media also doesn't take kindly to long-termism. Some, like Singer, complain that long-termism draws followers away from the effective altruism movement. Others argue that the technocratic vision of long-termists is also anti-democratic. For example, Time magazine wrote that Elon Musk has sold the fantasy that faith in the combined power of technology and the market could change the world without needing a role for the government. Christine Ember, in an opinion piece for the Washington Post, argued that the turn to long-termism appears to be a projection of a hubris common to those in tech and finance, based on an unwarranted confidence in its adherents' ability to predict the future and shape it to their liking, and that long-termism seems tailor-made to allow tech, finance, and philosophy elites to indulge their anti-humanistic tendencies while patting themselves on the back for their intelligence and superior IQs. The future becomes a clean slate onto which long-termists can project their moral certitude and pursue their techno-utopian fantasies while flattering themselves that they are still doing good. Okay, so now that we have seen what either side says, what are we to make of this? The logic of long-termists hinges on the question of what the value of a life in the future is compared to ours, while factoring in the uncertainty of this estimate. There are two elements which go into this evaluation. One is an uncertainty estimate for the future projection. The second is a moral value. It's how much future lives matter to you compared to ours. This moral value is not something you can calculate. That's why long-termism is a philosophical stance, not a scientific one. Long-termists try to sweep this under the rug by blinding the reader with numbers that look kind of sciencey. To see how difficult these arguments are, it's useful to look at a thought experiment known as Pascal's mugging. Imagine you're in a dark alley. A stranger steps in front of you and says, "Excuse me, I've forgotten my knife, but I'm a mugger, so please give me your wallet." Do you give him your money? Probably not. But then he offers to pay back double the money in your wallet next month. Do you give him your money? Hell no, he's almost certainly lying. But what if he offers 100 times more, or 1,000,000 times? Going by economic logic, eventually the risk of losing your money because he might be lying becomes worth it, because you can't be sure he's lying. Say you consider the chances of him being honest 1 in 10,000. If he offered to return you 100,000 times the amount of money in your wallet, the expected return would be larger than the expected loss. But most people wouldn't use that logic. They wouldn't give the guy their money no matter what he promises. If you disagree, I have a friend who is a prince in Nigeria. If you send him $100, he'll send back $1 billion. Just leave your email in the comments and we'll get in touch. The point of this thought experiment is that there's a second logical way to react to the mugger. Rather than to calculate the expected wins and losses, you note that if you agree to his terms on any value, then anyone can use the same strategy to take literally everything from you. Because so long as your risk assessment is finite, there's always some promise that'll make the deal worth the risk. But in this case, you'd lose all your money and property and quite possibly also your life just because someone made a promise that's high enough. This doesn't make any sense, so it's reasonable to refuse giving money to the mugger. I'm sure you're glad to hear that. What's the relation to long-termism? In both cases, the problem is how to assign a probability to unlikely future events. For Pascal's mugger, that's the unlikely event that the mugger will actually do what he promised. For long-termism, the unlikely events are the existential threats. In both cases, our intuitive reaction is to entirely disregard them, because if we didn't, the logical conclusion seems to be that we'd have to spend as much as we can on these unlikely events about which we know the least. And this is basically why long-termists think that most people who are currently alive are expendable. However, when you're arguing about the value of human lives, you're inevitably making a moral argument that can't be derived from logic alone. There's nothing irrational about saying you don't care about starving children in Africa. There's also nothing irrational about saying you don't care about people who may or may not live on Mars in a billion years. It's a question of what your moral values are. Personally, I think it's good to have long-term strategies, not just for the next 10 or 20 years, but also for the next 10,000 or 10 billion years. So I really appreciate the long-termists' focus on the prevention of existential risks. However, I also think they underestimate just how much technological progress depends on the reliability and sustainability of our current political, economic, and ecological systems. Progress needs ideas, and ideas come from brains, which have to be fed both with food and with knowledge. So, you know what? I would say grab a bag of chips and watch a few more videos. If you like science without the gobbledygook, we have a newsletter that you can subscribe to on my website, sabinehossenfelder.com/newsletter. You can support us on Patreon or right here on YouTube just by clicking on the join button below. Special thanks to our Patreon supporters, especially those of you in Tier 4 and higher. This channel would not be possible without your help. We now also have a gift store with t-shirts and mugs and stuff. Go check it out. Every little bit helps. Thanks for watching. See you next week.